हाँ சரி சரி தானே இந்த சாயங்காலம் பேசுகிறேண்ணா நீ போடு நான் பேசிட்டேன்
Good afternoon all. Once again, I welcome you all for the ACT sponsored short-term training program on electrical vehicle technology organized by Department of Electrical and Electronics Engineering, Panimalar Institute of Technology. So today's second session is about motoring regenerative operation of electrical drives by Dr. R. Dharmaprakash, Professor, Department of Electrical and Electronics Engineering, Panimalar Institute of Technology. Today we have an eminent speaker who has around 20 years of experience in teaching for undergraduate and postgraduate students in the Electrical and Electronics Engineering Specialization. He did his undergraduate in Electrical and Electronics Engineering at Kumaraguru College of Technology, and he did his Master's in Power Electronics and Drives in Sanhwa College of Engineering, and he did his doctorate in Sliding Mode Controller for Direct Torque Control of Multilevel Inverter Fed Induction Motor at Jawaharlal Nehru Technological University, Hyderabad. He has around 20 years of experience in teaching for the undergraduate and postgraduate students in Electrical and Electronics Engineering Specialization. Around 20 years of experience in various positions in academic and administrative positions. More than 12 years of experience in research in the field of power electronics and drives. He have more than 15 years of experience in NBA and NAC process. Proficient in prioritizing and completing tasks in a timely manner. He published around 10 papers in the international conferences, international journals, and he participated in various national and international conferences. He had a wide knowledge about the power electronics and drives control. Today he is going to give a wonderful session on motoring regenerative operation of electrical drives. With this note, I welcome Dr. Dharmaprakash, Professor, Department of Electrical and Electronics Engineering, Panimalar Institute of Technology, to take over this section. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, John, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, first of all, I want to thank our management of Vanimalar Institute of Technology and Department of Kupli Department to give the opportunity to present a session on the electrical motors for electrical vehicles. Okay. Thank you for all. Now we will start the session. Okay, our topic is electrical motors for electrical vehicles. Here, we know that these are the basic components of the electrical vehicles. So basic components are the first one is the battery and power electronic circuit, and to the power electronic circuit we are feeding the power to the motor, which is going to be act as a prime mover in the electrical vehicle. Usually in normal vehicles the IC engines are used as the prime mover, which will deliver mechanical power. Here, instead of using the IC engines due to various advantages, we are moving into the electrical motor to convert the electrical power into to deliver the mechanical power. So here, to charge the battery and maintain the battery, we need the battery controller and the battery management systems and all. And to deliver the power required by the electrical motor in the electrical vehicles, we need the power electronic circuits. So without the power electronic circuits, we cannot exactly deliver the power to the motor, so that it is not able to control the exact mechanical power. So it is very much important to use the power electronic converter between the source and the motor. So for that we need the motor controller to control the power electronic circuit to deliver the electric power required by the motor tank. Okay, so here already you have some aware of what are the types of batteries and the power converters required to control the motor and like that. Okay, now we are going to see only related to the motor. It is only the introductory level only we are going to see, not so much depth. So here, what are the motors that can be used in the electrical motor, electrical vehicles? So basically, we know that the basic classifications of the motor is DC motor, AC motor, and we know that we carry the AC power, we have to go for DC motors. Basically, it is the first evaluation of the electrical motor, so we can carry only the DC power. So at that time, we have to use only the DC motor in the electrical vehicles. You have to use the DC motor in electrical vehicles. But due to the evaluation of the power electronic circuits, we can use this DC into AC, so that we can use all the AC means in the electrical vehicles due to the evaluation of the power electronic circuits. So that all type of motors which are available can be used in the electrical vehicles. Only thing is, we have to analyze various types of motor which are having the advantage for this particular requirement, then we can use that corresponding motor. Okay. So actually, due to the perfect evaluation, we can use any motor at any type of application, because the control facility is available by using the power electronic circuits. Okay. So anyhow, we have to see what are the motors that can be used for electric vehicles, which are more suitable for electrical vehicles. Okay. So here, the basic motors. First one is the DC motor. Due to various disadvantages of DC motor, as we know, here it is using commutator brushes like this. Arrangements are there in DC normal motor. We are generally try to avoid the DC, basic DC motors. Okay, so we are not taking account here. Later we'll see. But the control facilities are very good in basic DC motors. But there is a lot of disadvantages in this. So we are now not considering the brushed DC motors. We are going with the AC motors and the brushless DC motor. The basic thing which we are used in electric vehicles are induction motor. That is, when we are considering the induction motor, generally it is the cage induction motor we have, and brushless DC motor, and permanent magnet synchronous motor, and the interior permanent magnet. It is also a synchronous motor. It is the interior permanent, okay, and then permanent magnet switch reluctance motor. it is switched collectors. So here these are the main motors which are used in electrical vehicles in the major companies. That is, these are the motors which are used in the major companies. Here it is the major companies which are used. These motors are the Tesla, BMW, Chevrolet, Toyota, Jaguar, Audi, and Nissan. Like this, we are having the major electrical vehicle manufacturers are using this type of motors. Okay, actually Tesla, they are trying only the induction motor. That is, they are having good control unit, developing a good R&D in the induction motor, so that they are using the induction motor in their high power cars. And BMW and all, now they are using the synchronous motor and the BLDC. So here, where we are using the induction motor? Here generally this in motor electrical vehicles, the two wheelers and the lightweight. Usually it is the lightweight two wheelers and four wheelers. So here the Tesla is using the induction motor in the four wheelers. And BLDC motors, actually this the BLDC motors are used in the lightweight two wheelers and the three wheelers. Two wheelers and the three wheelers. And the permanent magnet series motors are used in electric motorcycles and electric cars and electric buses. So they are used in the high power drives. And the interior permanent magnet IPM synchronous motor are used in the high performance motorcycles. So high performance means it will deliver the exact control over the drive. Okay, so that the cost will be more in case of interior permanent magnet motors, and the performance will be very good. And the permanent magnet switched reluctance motors are widely used in Tesla vehicles. Okay, so induction motors and the synchronous switched reluctance motors are used in Tesla cars. So now to analyze the motors, we have to compare all the motors used in the electrical vehicles. For this, we need to choose some of the parameters. How to choose the motors for the electrical vehicles? So the basic parameters which we are going to consider in this are the power to weight ratio, or the power to weight ratio, the torque speed characteristics, which is a very very important one, because based on the torque speed characteristics only the motor is going to run, right? So it is very much important. So the suitable torque speed characteristics and the efficiency of the drive and cost of the controller and cost of the motor. Okay, so when we need the very sophisticated control, the cost of the controller will be so somewhat a medium level accurate controllers, the cost will be less, right? And the cost of the motor depends upon the design of the motor and the magnet, permanent magnet we are using. Based on this, the car, the motor will go up and down, right? So first we'll take one by one the parameters for all the motors. So first we'll take the power to weight ratio. Power to weight ratio, so the ratio between peak power output of motor in kilowatt to weight. That is ratio of the kg. So the unit is kilowatt per kg. So what is power which can be delivered in terms of kilowatt per kg? And a motor with a high power to weight ratio is more suitable for electric vehicle application. Because in electrical vehicles, the vehicle itself is going to carry this motor. The vehicle itself, it have to carry this motor. So when it is driving the vehicle, it have to take this weight also. It have to overcome this weight also. Apart from the total weight of the electrical vehicles plus the passengers, plus the motor weight, plus this motor weight. So if you are choosing the huge motor, it will occupy more space and the weight. So we have to choose the motor which is having less which will occupy less space and which is going to deliver more power with less space. Okay, so that it is very much important parameter when we are considering for electric vehicle applications, because the space is very much limited. If you are taking the two-wheeler application, the space which we have to implement this motor in the scooter or the bike, the space is very, very, so within the small space we have to place the motor. For this, the motor should have high power capability with a small space and weight, right? So here different types of electrical motors with same power, voltage and speed ratings are compared. Here you can see the comparison. That is, it is in the scale of 5-point scale we are comparing. So here the power to weight ratio, here if you see the DC brushed, the normal motors, okay? So these are having the power to weight ratio is 2.5. But if you go for DC brushless motors, this BLDC motors, it is having the high power to weight ratio. So it will deliver power for a small motor. The small BLDC motor can deliver high power. So it is, if you see this comparison, the BLDC motor is going to deliver very high power compared with all motors. So the BLDC motor will be very, very having more advantages in this parameter. And the induction motor is comparatively, it is around 3 in the 5-point scale, and other synchro motor and SRM motors all are having the similar power to weight ratio. So when we are designing the lightweight vehicles, we have to go for this BLDC motors, so that it can get high power. It can provide high power for low weight ratio. Okay. In other cases, the average, that is more than 2.5, all these induction motors, synchronous motor, and the switched reluctance motors are delivering. So for when we are considering lightweight vehicles, we have to choose this BLDC motor. For others, we can choose on this parameter, we can choose induction motor, synchronous motor, and the switched reluctance motor. Next parameter which we are going to consider are the torque speed characteristics, because this is our requirement. That is, finally the electric vehicles are provided with the mechanical output. The mechanical power is nothing but the speed into torque. T into omega is the mechanical output. So we have to know what is the requirement first. What is the requirement? That is the requirement of the electrical vehicles. That is the mechanical power output, that is the torque and speed characteristics we have to know. Based on this, we have to match the characteristics of the motors, which will provide the same speed torque characteristics, or similar speed torque characteristics. Okay. Otherwise, we have to change the characteristics of the, easily change the characteristics of the motor to achieve the speed torque characteristics of the load. Okay. So you have to do the load match. So here we will see the, directly we will see the characteristics, basic characteristics of motors, and we can choose which is more suitable for the electrical vehicles. Okay. So the performance and suitability of an electrical motor for a particular application can be decided by its torque speed characteristics. The torque speed characteristics are also called as mechanical characteristics. The ideal mechanical characteristics of electrical motor for electric vehicle applications are, here you can see, is the ideal characteristics of the electrical vehicle. Is the ideal characteristics, the requirement of the electrical vehicle. To provide this characteristics only, you are going to choose the motor. Okay. So here it is the ideal characteristics. In this you can see, in the x-axis it is speed and the y-axis is the torque. Here the total operation of the electrical vehicle is split into two regions. One is constant torque region and another one is the constant power region. So here the speed, that is from the zero speed, the rated speed, generally the electrical vehicles are used as the constant torque, requires constant torque. And then from the rated speed and above that, it requires only the constant power. It requires constant power. The torque may be reduced, like as it is directly proportional to the speed. So the speed into torque will be maintained constant during this region. So here the electrical vehicles require two operation. One is constant torque operation, another one is the constant power operation. Already I think we are familiar with this characteristics. When we are dealing with the DC motors, here usually up to rated speed it can be operated in the constant torque region, and during this the constant power region the flux will be maintained constant. During the constant torque region flux will be maintained constant, and during the constant power operation it is a field weakening mode of operation, right? Later we'll see in detail. When an electric vehicle is used to bear frequent starting stopping, because in the low speed range often you are starting and stopping, so that it is required motor is operated in constant torque region, while at high speed it is operated in constant power region. So here these are the characteristics of the motors. So basic series and shunt motor characteristics are shown here. So we know that it is a series motor characteristics. Generally we are not choosing this because due to the control, the control is very difficult in the series motor. Generally we are not using this. Shunt motor, due to different losses in this DC motors, generally we are not using this. But anyhow, if you see this speed of characteristics here, the speed is constant during this shunt motor, in this shunt motor. And similarly, if you see this induction motor and the switched reluctance motor, here the induction motor, the maximum torque you are having at particular speed. So by varying the various parameters at as voltage and frequency, you can maintain this maximum torque for different frequency and voltage, or we go with the V by F control so that we can maintain this maximum torque. So by maintaining this, you can go with the constant torque operation. After that, by varying the speed, the torque may reduce, so we can also operate the induction motor at field weakening region. And if you see a speed of characteristics of switched reluctance motor, it is so much suitable for this electrical vehicle application. It is similar to the electrical vehicle requirement, the SRM characteristics. Here you can see that is up to this speed, the torque is maintained constant, and after that, the power is maintained constant. So this SRM motor, that is by seeing this speed of characteristics of the motors, here we can conclude that the SRM is more suitable for electrical vehicle application. But in case of induction motor or other synchronous motor will have the similar characteristics. So here we can use this induction motor and synchronous motors for this application. And third one is the important thing is the efficiency. The efficiency is the important parameter when we are considering the electrical vehicles, because why we are not using the gasoline fuels here, due to the efficiency, that is less efficiency of this one. Okay, if the efficiency is very high, then we are not going for electrical vehicles. That is, it is one of the parameter when we are going for the electrical vehicles. Okay, so still if we are using the electrical motors and having less efficiency, then there is no meaning of using the electrical motors in the electrical vehicle. Okay, so that here the efficiency of the motor, the overall system should be high compared with the, that is the IC engines, right? So here the efficiency of different motors are compared within this, which is having higher efficiency can be adopted. So here the one was the electrical energy into the mechanical energy. All of the input electrical energy is not converted in mechanical energy, but it is lost due to various factors. So we already know that what are the losses in the electrical motors. Okay? So the efficiency of the electrical motor gives relation between the electrical input and the useful mechanical output of the motor. All electric motors are designed to operate at maximum efficiency at rated output of motor. Electrical motors are designed to operate at maximum efficiency at rated output of a motor. When an electric motor is used in electric vehicles, motor will be operated at different loads. Motor will be operated at different loads because we know obviously the load may change. It cannot maintain the load in the vehicle as constant. So that is a different users are going to use the electrical vehicles. The weight of the user and the number of passengers and the load which are carried in the vehicle, everything may continuously differ. Okay, so we cannot design the motor, that is electric vehicle, for particular exact load. So always it is going to, that is the requirement. That is the requirement. The requirement we cannot change. Okay, so for requirement only we have to choose the motor. So when an electric motor is used in electrical vehicles, motor will be operated at different loads. Therefore, peak efficiency and efficiency at different loads of your motor must be considered. That is, we should not only consider at the rated condition what is the efficiency, like that you should not consider. For different types of loads, you have to consider what is the efficiency. Okay. So overall, the efficiency is good, then you have to choose the correct motor, right? Let us consider the comparison. The efficiency of different electric motors at peak load and 10% of load of comparative. So here, the motor type, when we are considering the brushed motor, that is a normal DC motor, here the peak efficiency is 85 to 90%, around 85 to 90% at full load condition. That is peak efficiency. And the efficiency at 10% of load, it comes down to 80 to 80%. So somewhat over 5% it is reduced. The load is reduced. That is, load is less, the efficiency is also less. Yeah. And the BLDC motor, always the peak efficiency is greater than 95%. It is greater than 95%. And it is fully loaded. The BLDC motor is delivering high efficiency. It is producing high efficiency, that is more than 95%. And the efficiency at 10% is very low. It's very, very low. It comes around 70 to 80%. It comes around 70 to 80%. And the induction motor. The induction motor, as we know that the induction motor is always having the high efficiency. So here, always it producing, that is, deliver more than 90% efficiency in peak load as well as 10% of the load. So here, it is 90%. And the synchronous motor, it is having high efficiency, that is more than 92% in peak load condition, and at 10% of the loading condition, it comes around 82%. And the switched reluctance motor, the switched SRO motor is less than 95% efficiency, and under loading condition, different loading condition, it is producing more than 90%. So from this, it is clear that the switched reluctance motors are very much suitable when we are considering efficiency, because it is always delivering the efficiency of 90 to 95% in different loading conditions. Okay, above 90 to 95%. Even though the BLDC motor is delivering high efficiency during no condition or low load condition, the efficiency is very poor. It is very poor. So generally, when we are choosing the BLDC motor, we have to use the electric vehicles at maximum load, at maximum loading condition. And then the induction motors are always delivering the high efficiency. Comparatively, it is more than 80%. And the synchronous motor is under low load condition, it is only around 80 to 85%. So from this table, it is clear that the induction motor and the synchronous reluctance motors are very much suitable for this electrical application. And when we are considering the control of the electrical vehicles, for their smooth and accurate control, we need the power electronic controllers, that is power electronic circuits and with controller. So the controller should be very, very accurate, and it should provide the smooth control over transition period. That is when there is a load change, when there is a speed change. So the dynamic control should be there when we are having a good performance. So for good smooth control of speed and torque requires a complex controller, because we have to take care of different parameters, okay, parameters, and we have to manipulate all the parameters to deliver the control signal to the power electronic converter, so that it will become complex. It will become complex. So that due to the complexity, the cost is also going to increase. It is going to increase. So a simple controller will be cheap, but the performance of the electrical vehicle will be low compared with this. Okay. So the cost of the controller, the motor controllers are very much important part of the drive electrical vehicle. A motor controller in electric vehicles offer improved performance, efficiency, and controllability. Motor controller in electric vehicle offers improved performance, efficiency, and controllability. So you can compare the cost of the controller which is used in Audi, BMW car, and the normal Tata, Tigo, and all. It is entirely different. The cost of the controller in the BMW itself is the cost of the total Tigo, Tata Tigo car. Okay. So it comes around the 5 lakhs or 6 lakhs. Like this, the cost of the controller in BMW itself, it comes around in terms of lakhs, right? Even more than this. So we have to consider the cost of the controller, which where we are going to use this controller. If an electric vehicle manufacturer wants to build a low-cost electric vehicle, the manufacturer wants to be low-cost electric vehicle, then choosing a low-cost controller would eventually affect the choice of the motor. So when we are using the low-cost controller, based on this only we are going to choose the motor. Okay. So when we are using the induction motor, the cost is less. So BLDC, it is cost is more. Okay. So the controller difference. Okay. Also, based on this cost, we are choosing the controller and the motor. For low voltage electric motor widely used in vehicle, cost of the controller of different electric motors with the same voltage output power rating are compared. So when we are comparing the motors, we have to take the same parameters for all the motors. Okay, so that we are taking the power rating motor and same voltage rating of the motor we are taking, and we are comparing here. So when you are comparing the cost of the controller, here you can see this, for the normal DC motors, the cost of the controller will be very, very low. It is very low. But for BLDC motor, the cost of controller is very high. Actually, why? So, for example, in case of induction motor or other motors, the controller, that is, even for the DC motor or the induction motor, there is no need for power electronic circuit. There is no need for power electronic circuit. We can operate the DC motor and the induction motor and the synchronous motor by using the conventional control method also, with conventional, using the rheostat, even though using a rheostatic control is enough to control the DC motor, induction motor, and the synchronous motor. But in case of BLDC motor or SRM motor, without the power electronic circuit, we cannot operate the motor. Even we cannot operate the motor. So that is must. Thus, in BLDC motor and the switched reluctance motor, the thyristor, power one thyristor circuit of the transistor circuit, it is acting as the electronic commutator. It is acting as the electronic commutator. So without this electronic commutator, we cannot operate the BLDC motor or the SR motor. So that automatically the cost will be increasing in case of BLDC motor. Already the cost of the motor itself is high, and the controller is also high in case of BLDC motor. And the induction motor, synchronous motor, and SR motor, usually the induction motor cost will be less, and the synchronous motor and SR motor, it is increasing. The induction motor, that is the sophisticated control of the induction motor, the controller, the cost is very high, that is before 20 years, before 3 decades, the cost of the controller of induction motor is very high, because at the time only, that is before 30-40 years only, the new control methods are proposed. That is complex and accurate control methods are proposed, like vector control method, direct control method are proposed before 30-40 years. So for the past 30-40 years, these methods are highly developed. So the cost now it is reduced. At that time, before 30-40 years, the cost very high. The control cost of the induction motor is very high. But nowadays, due to the development, continuous development of these controllers, now the cost is reduced. Even if you are considering the BLDC motor before 10 years, the cost of the motor is very high. Even a single kilowatt motor costs around 1 lakh. Similarly, controller will be, the cost will be more. But now the cost of the motor and controller is somewhat reducing. So for a long, if you are considering, the control cost will be continuously reduced. But now, exactly nowadays, what is the actual cost of the controllers for these motors are compared with it? Okay, after 10 years, the controller cost of the BLDC motor will also reduce. Okay, because of mass production and all, it is also going to be reduced. And final parameters which we are going to consider is the cost of the motor. So here, one of the important challenges ahead of electric vehicles manufacturer is to provide the consumer an electric vehicle which is as good as gasoline vehicle, but within an affordable price. That is our challenge, right? So cost of different electric motors with same voltage and power ratings are we are going to compare. So here, if you see the cost of it, as I already told here, BLDC motor cost is very high compared with all the motors. And the induction motor and synchronous are, we know that in case of DC motors, we need the additional arrangements and continuous maintenance and all. So that the cost of the DC motor is high compared with the induction motor. And the induction motor and synchronous motor, we are having a simple arrangements and easy construction, simplicity of the construction, the cost of the induction motor and synchronous motors are less compared with all other motors. Okay. Based on these parameters only, all the companies are working in electric vehicles. So now we'll conclude this comparison of all the electrical motors for electrical vehicles. Right. So the conclusion. A DC brushed motor are easy to control, provide high torque at low speeds, but have high maintenance cost. The main drawback in the DC motors are high maintenance cost, large size, low efficiency. These are the main drawbacks in the DC motors. When we are going with the BLDC motor, it has higher power to weight ratio, but its maintenance cost of the controller is high. Maintenance cost and the cost of the controller is high in this case of BLDC motor also. The three-phase induction motor provides efficiency more than 90% at peak load as well as 10% of the load. So when we are considering the efficiency, so efficiency is the important parameter, because when we are considering the vehicle, how long it will run for a charge. Right? How long it will run, kilometer per charge. Like this, we are going to compare all the motors. So it is giving good mileage. It is giving good mileage to the vehicle. So it is a very, very important parameter. So the three-phase induction motor provides efficiency more than 90% at peak load as well as 10% of the load. The three-phase induction motor and the BLDC motor are two most widely used motors by electrical vehicle manufacturers. The synchronous motor has higher efficiency at lower speeds and improves battery utilization and driving range. That is synchronous motor. That is, in synchronous motor, we are having different types of synchronous motor mechanics. The synchronous motor is preferred where constant is required. Where constant torque is required. The switched reluctance motors provide a great alternative to induction motor and BLDC motor with lower cost of motor and motor. That is, when we are considering the cost of the controller on the motor, is the SRO motor is better compared with others. Okay? And as well as the efficiency at the peak load as well as 10% of the load, and the reliability and fault tolerance capability. We can choose the switched reluctance motor, SRM motors. Okay. So these are the comparison of these motors which are used for electrical vehicles. Next we will see some of the control methods, some of the control methods of the motors which are used in electrical vehicles. We will start from the induction. Okay, the basic equations we already know. In induction motor, the synchronous speed can be written as 120 f by p. So here f is the supply frequency, data frequency, and p is the number of pits. So from this equation, it is clear that the speed of the motor can be controlled by varying the frequency, that is the stator or supply frequency, and the number of pits. Generally, the number of poles, even in conventional method, rarely they are using, because it can be used to vary the speed in terms of two or three steps only. Okay, so it is not the method. So generally, we are going with the frequency. From this equation, it is clear by varying the frequency, the speed of the motor, induction motor, can be varied. That is the synchronous speed. You keep in mind, it is the synchronous speed. And we know the voltage equation, that is the EMF equation of the motor, that is V1 is equal to 4.44 F by kW N1. So N1 is the number of windings and all, is the V1 is the voltage, supply voltage, right? V1 is the supply voltage, and you can see all the terms, kW, N1 are constant, 4.44 is constant. Let us consider this frequency and flux phi. Flux phi. So, varying the frequency, the flux can be varied. So, by increasing the voltage, the flux will increase. So, that when the flux is increasing, the torque developed by the motor will be increased. We know that the torque is directly proportional to the flux. So, obviously, by increasing the voltage, the flux will be increasing so that the torque can be increased from this. So continuously increasing the voltage, what will happen? Continuously increasing the voltage, it results in saturation, because continuously increasing the voltage, the flux is continuously increasing. So finally, it will result in magnetic saturation of the induction motor. So magnetic saturation means if there is a change in the flux, then only we can change the speed and torque. If it is saturated, we cannot change speed or torque. Okay, uncontrollable region. It will enter the uncontrollable region. And here, we are having the frequency at the right hand side. When you are bringing to the left hand side, it is 1 by f. So when we are considering 1 by f is proportional to this flux. So when we are changing the frequency, we are decreasing the frequency, the flux will increase. When you are increasing the frequency, the flux will decrease. So even by changing the frequency, the flux can be changed. So if you are increasing the frequency, the flux will reduce. If you are reducing the frequency, the flux will increase. So at lower frequency, when you are operating the induction motor at lower frequency, the machine will get saturated. So you should not go below, that is below the given frequency. There is a limit for this frequency. You should not go with this low frequency. And similarly, when you are continuously increasing the frequency, the flux will be reducing, continuously reducing, by increasing the frequency. So if the flux is not sufficient enough to drive the load, then apart from this, above this frequency should not go. Okay? So there is a limit for this frequency. So if you see the frequency limit, it is, this range of frequency is very, very limited. Similarly, the voltage is also limited. So here, within this limits only, we can operate the induction motor. But when we are considering the flux as within the level, within the limits or within the range, we are increasing and changing the both the parameter, voltage as well as the frequency. If you are changing voltage as well as the frequency, when you are increasing the voltage, you are also increasing the frequency. then this voltage by frequency ratio will be maintained constant, so that the flux can be maintained constant, or we can maintain the flux within the allowable range. So we can increase and decrease the voltage and frequency simultaneously, so that we can go higher range of speed control, higher range of speed torque. And here the third equation, this giving the relation between the speed torque and other is the stator supply and rotor resistance. R is the rotor resistance and rotor reactance and this slip. Okay, so here it is clear that the speed is proportional to the slip and rotor resistance R2. So that here S into E2 square R2, it is nothing but the slip power. Okay, so by varying the slip power, we can also vary the speed and torque. So from this, it is clear that the induction motor can be controlled either by stator side or by the rotor side. So it is clear that the induction motor can be controlled by stator side and the rotor side. From the stator side, it is stator voltage control and variable frequency control, stator current control, and V by F control and changing the number of poles on the stator. And from the rotor side, rotor resistance control and the engine EMF in the rotor. Okay. So this stator voltage control, because the induction motor is fed from the inverter. We are assuming that we are having the inverter. So by using the inverter, the output voltage of the inverter can be by varying the PWM of the inverter. Right. So suppose if you are using the AC voltage controller, so by varying the firing angle of the AC voltage controller, we can vary the stator voltage. And similarly, variable frequency control, if you are in the inverter, by varying the PWM, by using the PWM technique, you can vary the voltage as well as the frequency. So that we can vary the frequency, or we can use V by F control also. Generally, in static methods, we are not using the pole changing method. It is not the method which cannot be performed by power electronic converters, because the poles are inside the stator, so mechanically we have to do the change. And rotor side control, from the rotor side, the rotor resistance can be controlled. So here, how we can control the rotor resistance? Thus, in an induction motor, the rotor terminals are not available. The rotor terminals we cannot access. So to access the rotor terminals, we have to go with the slip ring induction motor. And slip ring induction motor only, we are having the motor terminals. Rotor terminals are taken out. So using these terminals, we can find the external resistance, or we can access these terminals. So we can inject the EMF into the rotor circuit. By this way, we can control the speed of the induction motor. So usually, this method is not applicable in the electric vehicles, because it requires additional hardware requirements and all. So generally, we are not going with the rotor side control of induction motor in electrical vehicles. So the simple methods which we can use, these are stator voltage control and V by F control. These are the methods. Effectively, the V by F control is more suitable for induction motor control in electrical vehicles. And apart from this, we can also control the induction motor in high performance control called the vector control and the direct torque control methods. So when you are going with this, we can sophisticate, we have the sophisticated control of induction motor. Usually in all the electric vehicles, when they are using the induction motor or BLDC motor or even switched reluctance motor, all the motors are controlled through this. VFD is what they are using. It is also the good method applied in electronics. So here you can see this. It is the characteristics of stator voltage control method. It is V1 is the rated voltage of the induction motor. That is the topmost speed torque in this. So at the time, this is the load which is matched with this. Okay. If the load is reduced, you can see this load curve. When this load reduced, to match this load, the voltage is reduced to V2, so that it is matched, but the speed is reduced. But the speed is reduced. So to reduce, that is to match the load torque, the voltage is reduced and now the speed is reduced to 10-2. To further reduce the speed, the voltage, then the speed is reduced to N3. Here the voltage is further reduced to V3. So by varying the voltage, here it is only the speed. So here we are this voltage, by reducing the voltage, the speed reduces. Similarly, we can increase the speed, right? So in this method, you can see this, the synchronous speed is not changing. The synchronous speed is not changing. And as well as the speed, when the maximum torque will be attained, will be at the same speed. You can see this, the maximum torque of all the curves are met at the same speed. Okay, here it is. So maximum torque speed is not changed. And when we are considering the frequency method, here, let us consider F3 is the base frequency. For example, the normal hertz, 50 hertz is the base frequency. So here it is the normal radar curve. This, the middle curve, third one is the radar curve. If you are reducing the frequency, here this curve is moved leftwards. So here, when you are changing the frequency, the synchronous speed is changing. The synchronous speed is changing. But in the previous method, the synchronous speed is not changed, it is same. Here, the synchronous speed is changing because synchronous speed is equal to 120 f/t. So when f is changed, automatically the synchronous speed is changed, okay? So here, the maximum torque is attained up to this frequency, that is the 50 hertz. Up to 50 hertz, the maximum torque can be attained. But when we are going above the base frequency, the radar frequency, the maximum torque that can be obtained by using the motor is reduced. So now the maximum torque obtained by this is reduced. But we can run the motor above this. And when you are continuously increasing the frequency, the torque developed, the maximum torque developed by the motor is very, very low. So it is not advisable to continuously increase the frequency beyond the limit. Okay. And when we are going with this V/N rule, both the things are maintained. Here, for all the frequencies, we can have the same maximum torque. We can maintain the maximum torque at constant because we are maintaining the fluxless constant so that it can be maintained constant. Here, you can see this, the no load speed can be increased and controlled. No load. And the starting torque also. Here, for higher frequency, the starting torque is reduced. When you are reducing the frequency, the starting torque will be more. Okay? That means the drive will move current. So, during starting of the motor, the frequency is increased. And after starting, we can continuously reduce the frequency for the required one. Then the current requirement will be reduced. Okay, we'll see this V/F control. Here it is the V/F control. So for V/F control, we have to, what is the, here it is the PWM inverter. So what is the frequency requirement? We have to give the control signal, and what is the voltage requirement? We have to give the signal. So these two command signals should be to the PWM inverter. Based on this PWM inverter operation, this output will be delivered to the induction motor. So this PWM inverter is connected with the DC supply. So here this LC of the filters to regulate this DC supply, because usually we are using some choppers to vary the DC supply and all to vary the voltage. At the time we always need the filters, but here that is not the constraint. Directly we are connecting the batteries. Please, so once again I'll come back. Okay, come back. Here in the PWM inverter, we are going to control the voltage as well as the frequency which is given to the motor. So we are providing the constant V by F control for the motor. So for that, what is the required frequency and what is the required voltage, that is we have to know. So based on this, the control signals will be generated for PWM inverter. Okay, so here the voltage of taken from this supply, that is stator voltage of sensor, so it is given to this controller, voltage controller. Okay, and the actual speed is taken from the rotor of the induction motor, and here it is the actual speed compared with the required speed. So here the required speed is that is required speed and the actual speed is compared, and the speed error signal is developed. So if the actual speed is less than the required speed, here the error will be positive, right? Otherwise it is negative. Okay, so based on the speed error sign and the magnitude, this signal will be, that is the slip regulator will deliver the slip speed, it will deliver the slip speed signal. So here this actual speed will be with this slip speed, and then it will give the required, and it will give the required speed. So here required speed means in terms of omega is 2 pi f. Okay, so this frequency signal will be given to the flux controller. So flux, we know that flux is equal to V by F. When we are considering flux as constant, we are giving the, that is from this we are having the frequency signal. So the required voltage signal is generated from the flux control unit. So this give the required voltage for this operation, and here the actual voltage is given. So by comparing this required voltage and the actual voltage of the stator, this will generate the voltage error, the voltage controller. Based on the voltage error, the voltage controller will deliver the required, that is here it is the modulation index of the PWM inverter. That signal will be delivered here, and the time duration for one cycle is decided from this. Here this is deciding the frequency, so it is delivered to this. So here this, the frequency and the modulation index of the PWM inverter is delivered. This command signal of the modulation index and frequency is delivered to the PWM inverter. Based on this, the PWM inverter will operate, and the constant V by F control will be given, and the constant flux operation will be offered to the motor, and the motor is cut, right? So this is the V by F control, stator side control, right? And here this V by F control, here up to here you can see this here up to, that is slip is 1. Slip is 1, it is running up to synchronous speed, right? That is 0 to 1. Slip 1, here is 0. So here you can see the speed torque at 6. It is frequency at per unit, at the rated frequency. One is 50 by 50, for example, it is right at the rated frequency, and continuously we are increasing the frequency. Here it is a torque, so it is 0. So when you are continuously increasing the frequency at 1, it is a rated synchronous speed. Up to rated synchronous speed or rated frequency, you can say speed or characteristics, it is maintained, the torque is maintained constant. So it is a constant torque region. It is a constant torque region. So you can operate the induction motor up to rated speed in the constant torque operation. Constant torque operation. So after this, you are continuously increasing the frequency up to 2.5 times of the rated speed frequency. For example, 50 hertz, 2.5 times means 125, that is 125 up to 125 hertz you are going. So here you can see this, only the torque is continuously reduced. Torque is continuously reduced and the speed is increased. So here the power is maintained constant. Here the constant power region, the torque into speed is maintained first up to this curve, and above this, once again, it is going above the above the right hand, that is here it is up to right hand speed, and up to allowable speed it is, and after that it will act as a series motor, that is the torque into omega square, it is maintained as constant. So T is constant, T into omega is constant, and T is 2 omega square is constant, and 1 minus 1 by T is proportionally inverse of the speed in one of the 4 types of loads, right? All 3 types of loads can be operated by using this method. So above the rate of speed, it is the field weakening method, because the F ratio is continuously reducing, it is reducing, the flux is reducing. Due to this flux is reducing, the field is weakened. So the field strength is reduced. So it is called as field weakening method. So the constant power region is called as field weakening region. Right. So already we see the ideal characteristics of the electrical vehicle. That is in something like a slide. Here. We have seen this, this ideal characteristics of the electrical vehicle. Here you can see this, it is constant torque region, it is constant power region, right? It is the field weakening region, right? So the induction motor characteristics can be same as this electric vehicle characteristics. So that the induction motor is more suitable for this. If we are not having any power electronic circuit, we are not able to bring this characteristics, right? So here you can see these other parameters, okay, torque, speed, voltage, frequency, flux and all. So here you can see this voltage versus the frequency. Here the torque is maintained constant up to the rated frequency, that is rated speed. Up to rated speed, the torque is maintained constant. After that, the torque is reduced. And further, the torque is reduced. Here it is the DC motor characteristics. Here it is the torque and constant power region, torque and speed, product of the torque and speed is maintained constant. And here you can see this flux weakening region, the flux is continuously reducing, so that it is called as flux weakening. Here you can see this, up to rated speed, the flux maintained constant. Here you can see this characteristic, the flux is maintained constant. And after this, the flux is reduced, continuously reduced. So this region is called as field weakening region, but the power delivered to the motor is maintained constant. And here you can see this, during the constant torque region, the current is controlled. Okay, the current is controlled. Here you can see this, the current is maintained constant up to this point. So when the current is maintained constant and the flux is maintained constant, so that the torque is maintained constant, but the voltage is continuously varying. So the voltage current into stator voltage is the power. Here it is up to the rated speed, the power is increasing. Gradually increasing, and at this point the motor reaches the rated voltage. After that we cannot increase the voltage. After the rated voltage, if you are applying to the winding, it will get more heat and it will collapse, right? So that it is not advisable to increase the voltage above the rated voltage. So here, after reaching the rated voltage, the voltage is maintained constant, only the frequency is increased. So when the frequency is increased, the flux is decreasing, the torque is decreasing, and the slip is gradually, it is starts increasing, right? This is a torque speed curve of the induction motor. And then next, we will come to the vector control of induction motor. This vector control is somewhat similar to all the AC machines. All the AC machines are, when we are using the machine as the AC machine, that is BLDC motor also we are using. Even we are giving the DC supply through the inverter, the excitation of each coils are controlled, okay, so that we can do this same vector control for the BLDC motor, synchronous motor, circular reluctance motor and all. So basically what is the vector control is, here we are giving the three phase supply to the induction motor, and this three phase supply will set up the stator magnetic field which are running in the sync field, which are running in the synchronous field. That is, what is the frequency in which frequency you are giving the supply, in the same frequency the magnetic field will be set up and it will run in the stator circuit, that is stator windings. Okay, so here we are having the conductor in the circuit, the conductor in the rotor winding, right, rotor winding. So here what will happen, due to the inductance, due to the induction, due to the induction, this will induce the EMF in the rotor winding. Okay, so this rotor current will flow through this winding and will set up one magnetic circuit. Okay, it will set up the one magnetic field. So this magnetic field and the synchronously running magnetic field in the stator will interact, will get interact. Okay, so usually this rotor frequency will be less than the stator frequency, so there is a difference in the frequency of the magnetic field, so that the rotor magnetic field try to catch up the stator magnetic field, so that the rotor starts continuous rotation and to try to catch up the synchronously rotating magnetic field. Okay, so like this we are having, so here we are having stator supply, that is a three phase induction motor. We are having phase A voltage, phase B voltage, phase C voltage, and similarly all these three currents we have to consider. And similarly in rotor side we are having three phases. Okay, so here when you are considering this, all these parameters, there are lot of parameters we are having, so exactly we don't know which parameter to be varied, which parameter to be varied. So simply we are doing that stator voltage control, stator frequency control, RF control, rotor side rotor resistance control, like this we are doing. Okay, so in case we are having the DC motor, when we are studying the DC motor, we are having major two types of speed control method. One is armature control method, another one is the field control method. In armature control method, simply we are changing the armature voltage by varying the field, that is the flux. Automatically the field control method we are implementing. So up to rated speed we are using armature flight control, and above rated speed we can use the field control. If we are able to model the induction motor as a DC motor, then the same method can be applicable for the induction. If the same method can be applicable for the induction motor. So here in induction, that is a DC motor, torque is proportional to constant into IA into IF. That is, IA is the stator current, F is the field current. Field current. Okay. So based on this, the rotor flux and the stator flux will be set up. That is, the rotor flux is set up by the field current and the stator flux is set up by the armature current. Okay, so like this we can take, let IA is the stator current, IS and IF is nothing but the rotor current. Okay, it is directly proportional to IA. Okay, like this if you are taking, by varying the torque component and the field component, then control the motor. So by varying the stator current, we can vary the motor speed up to the field side to vary the motor. So the same analogy we are going to use. So for this, what we have to do, first the three phase quantities should be converted into two phase quantity. In this two phase quantity, in this two phase quantity, we are having two parameters referred to armature and one is referred to field. So the parameter which is referred to armature can be easily controlled, that is the stator current or stator voltage. Current is proportional to the voltage. Okay, so by varying the stator voltage, you can implement the armature control in the induction motor. So that is the basic idea which is behind this voltage control of, sorry, vector control of induction motor. Okay, so here you can see this, we are having the inverter. The inverter is from this DC supply, and it is having three phase output. It is having three phase output. The same thing we can implement. Here the state of current components are split into two, IDS and IQS. The state of component is split into two, is IDS and IQS. IDS and IQS is nothing but this Q-axis, Q is a quadrature component and D is a direct axis component. The three phase quantity, IAS, IBS and ICS, three phases ABC are converted into two phase, that is three axis and two axis of math one. So it is called as path transform. Already you are somewhat familiar. Anyhow, it is not important. Just you get the basic idea, that's enough. Okay. So here, from these two components, we are giving the control signal, and based on this, it will produce the PWM in the inverter, PWM control to the inverter. So then the induction motor can be controlled as the DC motor. So here you can see this, the torque component and the flux component. Here you can see this IS. This is the IS, is that, and that is the, it is the resultant of three phase quantities. It is the resultant of three phase quantities. So it is converted into quadrature axis and the direct axis. This x axis is the quadrature axis. So here this IS is split into, it is the IQS. And another term in the y axis, here it is IDS. We are having two parameters. It is two parameters, okay? So here the angle is theta. Here this is the angle between the resultant and this. Okay. So now here the torque components we are going to increase. The torque components, that is the Q, IQ component is increased. So what will happen when the IQ component is increased? Thus, due to this, we are maintaining this flux component as constant. Okay. So the resultant state of current requirement is changed. Now it is changed. The magnitude and the angle is now it is changed. So these are parameters we have to calculate. This control for this change. Okay. So if you are increasing the flux component, what will happen? Here this DS is the flux component and it is increased. Here this resultant current, here it is increased like this. Resultant state of current requirement is increased like this. Okay. So here by calculating this DS and QS quantities from the actual value to and the required value, you are able to this IS requirement and you can control this.
Hello.
So basically these are the transformations which are used in vector control method. So actually here IDS star and IQS star, from where we are getting? From the stator terminal of the machine. That is stator terminal of the machine, we are paying in IA, IB, IC. IA, IB, IC will be taken. That is the phase A current, phase B current and phase C current. And the resultant will be derived. And the resultant current IS, this IDS and the IQS will be derived. This will be derived. Okay, so it is, so when we are having this the change in the angle, okay, magnitude will be found using this and the angle will be delivered this. So the vector rotation will be done. Then you will have the required IQ and ID parameters. And when you are giving, that is controlling the inverter, this is the three phase inverter we are giving, having, okay. For this, we provide this control signals, okay. So it is having different states. For this, we have to, at a time, we have to deliver three control signals, okay. So for this, we have to convert these two phase quantities into three phase quantities so that we can have the requirement of state of current IA and IB, IC. So it is the required thing. So it is given to the inverter. This dotted lines, in between we are having the inverter, let it be the unity gain. So what is the requirement that will be delivered by the inverter? So IA star is delivered as IA. The required current is delivered IABC. So here we are having, the inverter is not shown here. So this will be converted into the required current and current IDS and IQS to the machine terminals. Okay. So that the machine will be controlled. question will be right? So basically this involves only the transformation equation, that is Clark transformation and the inverse Clark transformation. Like this we are having the transformation equations. So the modeling is not not suitable for this session. So simply you understand that. So it is a block diagram for direct vector control method. This is a block diagram for direct vector control of induction motor. So here we are having some voltage and this current gauge sensor, and the current that is the speed of the motor is sensed. Okay. So from the voltage and the current, current measurement, we can find this angle. Okay, find the angle and the unit vector is generated, and it is multiplied with the actual requirement of the IDS and the IQS. That is the torque and flux requirement, right? So this will be operated. This it is always involved. So it is one way of doing this vector control by taking the speed as a feedback, and the speed is compared with the required speed. Speed is compared with the required speed, and here it is again. It is maybe the PA controller like this, and the flex command we are setting up for the required speed. So that is on the required speed, writing the flex command, and the actual speed is. The actual flux is compared with this, and through the PA the rotation block. So this is what to the by the unit vector. Generally, this includes the phase change. Okay, the angle which is to be changed. So it is generating this, and then this is the actual requirement. It is in a two-phase quantity, so the inverter will be operated by the three-phase quantity. So this two-phase quantity is converted into three-phase quantity. So it is generating the control signal for this inverter, and it is so in some sophisticated control. If you are not able to sense the speed continuously, sense the speed, because to avoid the sensor. Operation the sensor or mechanical sensor which is going to convert this mechanical parameter speed into the electricals, due to the reliability problem, there is any problem may occur, so that we can go for a sensorless control. So that what will do, they will do here, they will simply sense the supply side parameter, that is the state of voltage and current. Based on this, they will estimate the torque and speed of the motor. But you have to consider all the parameters, and you have to take all the position of this temperature and other parameters of the motor. Then only the model will be very good. Then the sensorless control will be good. Okay, it will give the good performance. Otherwise, if you leave some of the parameters, parameter is not good, then the result will be very poor. Okay. So like this also we can do for electric vehicles. So it is indirect vector control, and here it is the speed of characteristics of the induction motor. So here the inverter can be operated in two modes. One is the square wave mode, that is square wave mode, that is otherwise six step inverter. It will act as a six step, or we can use the PWM mode. When we are using the square wave mode, the DC, that is the output voltage, will be controlled externally by using the DC chopper. Generally, we are using the DC chopper in square wave mode to control the voltage, and to change the frequency, we are using the inverter. And in case of PWM mode, both the parameters, voltage and current frequency, can be controlled within the inverter itself. Okay. So here it is a constant torque, constant power mode are shown in this. So here the dotted lines are showing the square wave mode. So here we can go for higher rating when we are operating with the square wave mode, since the voltage is controlled externally. It is a direct torque and flux control method. So it is the sophisticated control method, because in each instance, in each sampling period, we are taking the actual vector position of the stator. Okay, actual vector position of the stator, and then based on this vector position, we are continuously changing the, that is injecting the vector. So here, the torque and flux is calculated from this current and voltage from the stator of the motor. Okay, and the angle also we are calculated. From this, the required torque and the required flux is calculated from the rotor speed, and this is compared on the torque error and the flux error are generated. Torque error and flux error is generated. So here we are using two hysteresis band controllers. One is for flux and one is for the torque. So we are having the hysteresis controllers. So this will find if it is error is positive, flux error is positive or negative. Based on this, it will generate the control signal. Similarly, the torque error, it will check it is positive or negative. Based on this, it will generate the control signal. It will choose the voltage vector from the vector table. From the vector table, it will choose the vector. Okay, so for that corresponding firing pulses will be applied to the inverter and it will be operated. Okay, so here we will see this how it is happening. Okay, so here you can see this point A. Now the motor is having the flux at this point A. Okay, now the motor is in the sector one. That is, each sector of this DQ axis is split into six sectors. Each sector is having 60 degrees. It is in the sector one. The flux is in sector one, and it is at the point A. Now I want to increase the flux. So what I have to do? I have to add the vector. Which vector is suitable for this position? I have to know that vector will be added. Here the I am choosing the vector V3 is added. Okay, so that what will happen, this vector is added here, the resultant vector will be moved to point B. Now this flux vector will enter the sector 2. So now it is coming into the sector 2. Like this, it have to continuously rotate. For this, continuously I have to add the vector in a sequence so that it is continuously moving and generating the required flux. So here you can see this, how we are choosing the flux vector. Here it is the state of flux here. To increase the flux, which here we are having six flux vector. So which will increase the magnitude here? Which will increase the magnitude here with moving in the anti-clockwise direction? So here it is clear that del 3, that is a flux, third flux vector is used for increasing the flux here. Okay, suppose I want to decrease the flux here, because I want to decrease that, we have to choose the sixth vector. Okay, so here for this we are having the table, right? So the first column is the flux error, second column is the torque error. Let us consider it is a positive error. So we have to increase the flux. And let us consider the first row, the torque error is positive. So here, what is the meaning of this one and this one? The flux is to be increased and torque is to be increased. Now we have to see in which sector the vector, that is the vector. So the vector is in the, if the vector is in the first sector, the vector V2 should be selected. The vector V2 is selected, then if this vector V2 will increase the torque as well as the flux. Suppose I want to increase the flux, but I want to maintain the torque as it is, I have to choose the voltage vector 0. Voltage vector 0. If I want to maintain the, I increase the flux and decrease the torque, then I have to choose V6. V6 should be chosen, right? In case I want to reduce the flux, that is minus 1, and increase the torque, I have to use V6. So this in sector 1, the vector v3 will increase the torque as well as it will reduce the flux. It will reduce the flux. And to maintain the torque as it is and to reduce the flux, vector v7 will be taken. And to reduce the flux as well as the torque, v5 will be taken. So that is the meaning of this vector. Okay. So here, this in 1, here, you can see this. This in the sector 1, if you are adding 2 and 6, you can see 2 will increase the flux as well as the torque, and 6 will reduce the flux as well as the torque. Both are reduced. And if you maintain, that is 1 and 4 will maintain the torque as it is, and if this 4 will decrease the flux, and 1 will increase the flux. You can see this. Here it is. Okay, like this we have to understand. So here the voltage vectors, the impact of voltage vectors on flux and torque. So when we are applying the voltage vector V1, the flux will increase and torque will decrease. That is not fully decrease, a small decrease in torque. When the vector V2 is applied, the medium increase in flux and the medium increase in torque. And V3, when the voltage vector V3 is applied, a high decrease in flux and a high increase in torque, right? High decrease in torque. And when vector V4 is applied, high decrease in flux and low increase in, a small increase in torque. And here V5 is used for decreasing flux and torque in medium. Medium flux will be reduced. And here torque will be increased medium. And when the flux is, there is vector V6 is applied, there is a small increase in flux, the medium decrease in torque. And when these zero vectors, V0 and V7 are called as zero vectors, there is no change in flux, but the torque will reduce. The vector V1, V2, V3, V4, V5, Adingradala, nothing is based on the switching state. For example, here you can see this V1. In the inverter, we are having upper arm and lower arm device. In the upper arm, you are having 3 device, and lower arm, you are having 3 device. Okay. So in the upper arm device, 1 means the upper is on. This 100 is called as the upper arm device. Okay, so 1 means on, 0 means off. So in the upper arm, we are having 3 device. First one is on, first leg device is on, second leg device is in off, third leg device is in off. And similarly in the lower arm, this will be get complicated. So complemented, this will be take complemented. So 1 complement it is 0, and for 0 it is 1, 0 it is 1. The lower arm devices, first leg is, second leg is on, third leg is on. So we can implement this vector V1 by turning on the switch in the upper arm, first one, and in the lower arm, second and third one. Okay. So like this, we can implement these vectors. Okay. So and then permanent magnet synchronous motor, the same vector control methods can be used. Only the model equations, there is a small changes in the equations, we have care of that parameters one. You can see this final vector rotation, 2-phase to 3-phase conversion, everything are same here. It is also a similar torque speed characteristics. So up to base speed, here the torque is constant. And IS, the stator current is constant, so that the flux is constant. And after that, the voltage is maintained, and here it is constant power mode. And here it is synchronous reluctance motor. Synchronous reluctance motor, it is also, the vector control can be improved. And here it is for IP, interior permanent magnet synchronous motor. Yeah, for square wave operation and PWM operation, generally, FWM operation is up to base speed and above small, and after this constant power operation, after certain range, the square wave inverter is used, right? It is a BLDC motor. So in this BLDC motor, they are using the position sensor. Actually, Hall effect sensor is used in this. So the switching is on 100 means here we are having the inverter. That is Q1, Q3, Q5, Q4, Q6, Q2. So 100 na, here Q1 is 1 on, Q3 is off, Q5 is off. In same leg, any one device will be in on condition, right? So Q3 is off. In the below device, Q6 is on, Q2 is on. So that is the vector generation, right? So the difference between the TMSM and the BLDC motor, here it is a trapezoidal EMF generation, there it is a sinusoidal EMF generation. That is the thing. So here it is 120 degree mode of operation we are using. So at the time, that is two switches will be in on condition. You can see this is a switching sequence of the BLDC inverter. So here it is Q1, Q3. In the rectal control method and director control method, we are operating three switches at a time. But in this, we are having the excitation is done with two switches. That means at a time, only two windings are energized. Okay, then only we can have this trapezoidal excitation. That is a trapezoidal EMF will be generated. Okay, these are things that I want to deliver for you. So I think I have given some idea about what are the motors that can be used for electric vehicles and what parameters we are choosing for selection of motors for electrical drives, that is electrical vehicles, and the basic characteristics of the various electrical motors suitable for electrical vehicles, like induction motor, SRO motor, BLDC motor, and all. I think I have given some idea related to this. Okay, so you can refer some of the books I can show you. It will give the entire things which is required for the further studies. Okay. This AC motor control and electrical vehicles applications. This is giving the good idea about all the things, even all the dynamic and all this thing. Here you can see this induction motor control and the permanent magnet AC motor and the TMSM control methods, EV motor design. Until dynamics also they are given. Vehicle dynamics, hybrid vehicles, like this, everything. Yeah. I'll get the group and I will put it in the group ID. Okay. This thing you can refer. Have any clarification related to this, please? Anybody having any clarification? John sir.
Sir.
John sir.
Ah sir.
என்ன வைண்ட் பண்ணிரலாமா?
ஆ பண்ணிரலாம் சார்.
ஆ?
பண்ணிரலாம் சார்.
ஓகே.
பார்ட்டிசிபன்ஸ் யூ ஹேவ் எனி டவுட்ஸ்? ஓகே சார். சார் थैंक यू so much for your spending a valuable time with us sir. We had a wonderful session on motoring and regenerative operation of electrical drives sir. Your session was very knowledgeable to us. I hope participants gain more information regarding this motoring and regenerative system, breaking of the systems, right, of electrical drives. Thank you very much, sir. And participants, if you have any doubt, you can ask, no? And dear participants, feedback form is posted in the chat box. So kindly fill the feedback form. Feedback form is mandatory for getting your certificates and it is mandatory for your attendance. So kindly fill your feedback forms. And once again, I thank you, sir. The participants. Okay, sir.